Okay, now go back to Romans chapter 8 again. He says, we're not supposed to trust in the flesh. We're not supposed to, you know, it'd be better if we could just forget about the flesh and just think, I'm not a flesh, I'm a spirit. That's what he's getting ready to say. Verse 5. I need to keep going. These are really good, and we could spend a lot of time on each one of these verses. Verse 5, for they that are after the flesh do mind the things of the flesh, but they that are after the Spirit, that's us, by the way, the things of the Spirit. For to be carnally minded is death. Now, that means to be mindful of the flesh, and to be trusting in the flesh, and to be thinking of yourself as a flesh person. What does he mean, to be carnally minded is death? This is important to get your conception around. Does he mean if you think in a carnal way or a fleshly way, you're going to fall over dead? No. No. He doesn't mean that. When Paul uses the word death here, he uses it as a sort of a metaphor for everything wrong that came to the human race because of Adam. Back in chapter 5, he said, by one man sin entered into the world, and so death by sin. Death became a force. What did he call it back in verse 2? He said the law of sin and death. By this he means, when he says carnally minded is death, he means all the things that are, all the bad things, all the negative things that came into the human race because of sin. And he says to be carnally minded gives sway to that force of death. Anton, give me the Amplified just for a second. Sorry, I didn't mean to make you jump. Now the mind of the flesh, which is sense and reason without the Holy Spirit, is death. Notice how it amplifies what death means. Death that comprises all the miseries arising from sin, both here and hereafter. But the mind of the Holy Spirit is life and soul peace. Life and peace, both now and forevermore. Notice he says all the miseries arising from sin. Well, what are some of those miseries arising from sin? Well, one of them he mentioned in verse 1, condemnation. Fear, condemnation, those kind of things all come along with that. It comes under this umbrella of what it means to be, what it means by death. Now go back to the King James again just for a second, Anton. To be carnally minded is death. That means when you think, if we allow our minds to run purely along carnal, human, fleshly tracks, if you think of yourself purely in a fleshly sense, he said it's going to do nothing good for you. It's going to produce misery in you. It's going to produce anxiety and fear and all those negative kinds of emotions and thoughts. But by contrast, to be spiritually minded is life and peace. What does that mean? Don't think of yourself as a flesh. Think of yourself as a spirit. I know, I'm using bad grammar there. Don't think of yourself in a carnal sense. No, think of yourself in terms of who you are in Christ, who we are in the Spirit, who we are in union with Christ. If you think in that way, it delivers you from all those negative things. He says it's life and peace. Verse 7 says, the carnal mind, or the mind given to thinking in a carnal way, is enmity with God, for it is not subject to the law of God, neither can it be. So they that are in the flesh cannot please God. Or those that are, you know, in other words, the flesh can't please God. That goes back to Philippians when he said, I remember when I used to trust in the flesh. And we could have trusted in the flesh and had confidence in the flesh. But he found out he couldn't please God. By the way, can I tell you how to please God? You want to know how to please God? Does anybody get the Alvary Review Courier? Because I'm in the Ministerial Alliance, another thing they make us do, I shouldn't say make us do, another thing we get to do, we have an opportunity to and it's a real blessing. And another thing we get an opportunity to do is we get to write newspaper articles once every so often and got to come up with a new one all the time. And so I got to do one. It was in Friday's paper, and I wrote an article, What Pleases God? And I'll give you a little synopsis of it. Look in Hebrews chapter 11 just for a second. You want to know what pleases God? I'll tell you. It tells us right here. Hebrews chapter 11, verse 6. I'm not going to try. Just read it. Put it up there, Anton. But without faith, it is impossible to please him. For he that cometh to God must believe that he is, and that he's a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. Notice that it says, without faith, it's impossible to please him. So what is it that pleases him? Faith. Yeah. Yeah. If it's impossible to please him without faith, see, what's remarkable to me about that verse is all the things he didn't say. See, what we think in our very pious, holy, here we are in church Sunday morning way, what we think in our Christian, you know, part of our minds, or I shouldn't say Christian, our religious part of our minds, what we think is what he's going to say is without a holy life, without being perfect, without, you know, walking a straight path, it's impossible. That's what we think instinctively. But notice he doesn't say that. It's kind of shocking. He says, without faith, it's impossible. Think of all the things he could have said. Without faith, it's impossible to please him. You know why it says that? Because he knows we don't have the capacity to do it ourselves. He knows we don't have it in us. All of our best efforts fall short. That's true. I'm telling you the truth now. So he knows only he can do it. So the only way he's going to do it is if we'll quit trying to do it ourselves and trust him to do it in us. I liked a verse that the minister that did the service yesterday, Mr. Kirkpatrick, used. He was reading from the Message translation in Psalm 84, and it said something to this effect, that we are the road that God travels through life. That's a beautiful thought. We're the road that God travels through life. That's the way to look at it. He has to do it. You know, we can't pull it off. He's got to do it. And how does he do it? When we trust him, when we put our faith in him, when we rely on him to do it.